The night is May 18th, 2016. Cheeto Hitler isn't president yet, forest final for firemaking isn't a thing, and Corona is a brand of beer. Life and Survivor are still good. In fact, you are finishing up a season that has been rather good. I mean, it's not going to be an all-time classic, and I certainly, unfortunately, have to be in the shadows of the season that came right before it, Cambodia. I mean, any season would suffer in comparison to the sheer thrill and joy that Cambodia was. But aside from some terrible moments, courtesy of the worst Survivor contestants ever that aren't literal felons or named Dan Sbylo, this has been a rather inspiring season, in no small part thanks to the evolution of who is to become the 30s most iconic character, Aubrey Bracco. Watching her story has been nothing short of amazing. Watching her transform from someone who was having a mental breakdown on day two to someone who clung her way to a power position and eventually reached the final three, it's been great. Clearly, this inspiring story can only mean one thing. Aubrey is about to find herself into a club that at this point has only 30 people in it. It's obvious she's going to win, unless you're one of those weirdos that uses terms like M-O-R-P or O-T-T-N and thinks that Michelle is going to win for whatever reason. Look, Jeff is counting the votes now.
2 votes Michelle, 2 votes Aubrey.
2 votes Michelle, 2 votes Aubrey. He always includes the votes of the runner-up alongside the votes of the winner to add some suspense. I still know where this is going.
Michelle. That's 3 votes Michelle, 2 votes Aubrey.
Huh. 3 votes Michelle. Well, that's interesting. I wonder what that means.
The winner of Survivor, Michelle.
What? Okay, so you know how sometimes during these reviews I will hyper-focus on one element and talk your ear off about that? Yeah, that's what we're doing today. Because, for the most part, this season really has only one main talking point. I mean, it's not the only thing people talk about. Some people talk about how awesome Sydney is and how we definitely need to see her again. Some people talk about Ty and his awesome arc. And some people make the egregious mistake of calling this the last good Survivor season ever. Because as you know, if certain contestants aren't verbally abusing others, well then there may as well not be any emotional stakes at all, right?
Opportunity. Can I tell you something that I haven't told anyone in this game? What? My mom has stage 4 lung cancer. And she's already been through 3 treatments. And I found out when my brother came that the 3rd one isn't working either. That's why it's been so much to me doing it for her. She wants to watch me get to the end. That's why I can't waste this opportunity.
I've been scared for the past 9 years and my mom's gonna die, bro.
I'm so scared.
Anyway, like Samoa, the main focal talking point of this season are the controversial final tribal counts results of Michelle versus Aubrey. If you were in the fandom during and right after the finale, you would know that the message boards were absolutely fucking bombarded by an all-out war between fans who thought Aubrey was robbed and weird, boring people who apparently really wanted bad television to be rewarded as good gameplay. Now, I'm getting a bit ahead of myself here, but from where I'm sitting, the main fatal flaw of Kaoh Rong is that it doesn't do a good enough job justifying its own ending. In layman's terms, it makes no sense that Aubrey lost, and doubly so that she lost at Final Tribal Council. Like, that's the thing you have to understand when analyzing this season. It's not just a bunch of bitter fanboys angry that their favorite lost. Okay, it's not just that, but it's also that this just doesn't compute. In what universe does Aubrey's story look like this, and she ends up losing? It just doesn't make any sense. You know how I talk about why blank lost type seasons? Yeah, the whole problem with the season is that it should be one of those seasons, but by all rights, it isn't. Aubrey isn't shown to be volatile to the jury like Russell or Twyla was, she isn't hypocritical like Coach was, and she doesn't make certain members feel like they broke their bros before hose code like Boston Rob made Lex feel. Now, not everyone was blindsided by Michelle's win the way the general audience was. There was a subsection of fans who correctly predicted right from episode 1 that Michelle was going to win. But these people were using a specific type of fan analysis that's much more complex than just sitting back and watching the show. No, you see, that could be mistaken as fun, and the Survivor fandom, we can't have that. No, instead of just sitting back and enjoying the show and letting it unfold the story week by week, these people created a whole new system that painstakingly analyzes the edit bit by bit, frame by frame, to figure out ahead of time who the winner is, and that is called edgic. Fucking Kaoh Rong, you're making me talk about edgic. Fucking hate you. Okay, so, what is edgic? Fucked if I know. Apparently, it's the art of deciphering the winner ahead of time, from episode 1 even, and its name is a forced combination of the words editing and logic. The idea is that because there's so much raw footage that the producers cover from, you know, the 39 days of gameplay, what we see is not random. I mean, how could it be? Every episode is essentially 72 hours of raw footage toned down to 45 minutes of whatever the producers have deemed essential for us to see. So why wouldn't they choose specific things for us to witness? It's the producer's job to create a cohesive story, and they have months of time between the filming and the airing of the season. So of course, nerdy fans being nerdy fans came up with a whole bunch of different groups that different players might find themselves being in. Terms like MORP, CPN, OTTNN, and other random bullshit that was fucking completely meaningless to me. Because while yes, I understand and respect the science behind edgic, I'm not going to look that much deeper into it, and I'm not going to take part in it, because if I had to do any more research than the bare minimum I had to do to make this section of the video, it would completely suck all the fun out of the show for me. Because at that point, you're not watching a TV show, you're doing homework. You're analyzing bit by bit what the story is trying to tell you, instead of just letting the story be told. Case in point, bringing it back to the season we're actually talking about, edgicers apparently knew ahead of time that Michelle was going to win, and they plastered it everywhere, this big hidden secret, on social media, completely ruining it for everyone else. And this is where I admit to a little fib, because despite what I may have alluded to earlier, I was not actually in the fandom during the airing of Kaoh Rong. I did not witness this all-out war between the Aubrey and Michelle stands. I was watching the show live at the time, but I was not as deep in the fandom as I am now. And honestly, thank goodness for that. I'm so glad I wasn't in the fandom at that time. I can't imagine the utter defeat of having to watch the season and never once being able to think that Aubrey or Sydney might have been the winner. Because edgic, at least in the context of this season, it was correct, but it's not very emotionally satisfying. Michelle's win was predetermined, not because of the content of her story, but because of her awkward, sometimes artificial placement into scenes where she doesn't particularly have much to do with the story at hand. Despite not being involved with the main conflict of the season, we always come back to her. The editors make a point to let us know how she's feeling at any given moment, and we often hear her perspective on things, even though at first glance, we don't seem to need to. And her constant visibility, despite being functionally unimportant to the season story at hand, was what gave edgicers the knowledge of, oh, she's the winner. And while that's accurate, is it really enjoyable? It's clear that at least in the context of this season, edgic was right, but at that point it's more like solving a math problem instead of, like, an actual enjoyable piece of television. Trying to bum-rush the storytelling instead of just letting the story naturally play out. I touched upon this kind of thing in the WandaVision review, but this creation of edgic seems more like a symptom of fandom's nasty habit to have to know the ending right away, instead of just living in the moment and watching the damn season. It's also important to note that outside the context of meticulously analyzing every second you see on screen to figure out who the winner is because fun is something you're allergic to, Kaoh Rong isn't particularly satisfying storytelling, is it? A character that's honestly best described as a minor character being shoved into the role of main character is exactly what it sounds like. Awkward and clunky. I would have more of a problem with this if Survivor wasn't a reality show. I mean, it's not like the editors can just make up the ending of the season. That's literally the thing they're beholden to. They have to work with what they've got. And if the winner of the season was someone who was barely involved with what was happening, but the editors still want to set her up so that when it turns out she was the most important person of the season, fans aren't completely blindsided by it, well, then you need to shove in some awkward confessionals. Unless, of course, you want to go the route of other seasons with under-the-radar winners like Samoa or Guatemala or South Pacific, where you don't really showcase the winners all that much, and instead give most of the screen time to more interesting and relevant characters of the story. But of course, fans get pissy when you do that, and insist that you must sprinkle in forced confessionals, regardless of whether or not they would actually flow with the story, and whether or not they were needed or interesting. So, we get this. A very good season that has very good characters and very good editing most of the time, but sometimes is very concerned with showing you why this woman who has never been to Tribal Council is really interested in the tribe swap. And despite this season being rather good, this feeds into one of the reasons why the ending left a lot of people rather cold, beyond just being upset that our favorite lost. But we'll get into that in a bit. First, we gotta talk about... To the annoying hipsters who think that Survivor is only good when people are acting awfully to each other, yet also inexplicably think that Boston Rob was acting too mean-spirited in Redemption Island because he was voting people out, Kaoh Rong is the last good season of Survivor because it is the last one with real villains, not counting Island of the Idols or that one episode in Game Changers because those were just vile people outside the confines of the game. Although I have heard people say that Island of the Idols is better than David vs. Goliath because they at least felt something, because this fandom can be fucking gross sometimes. According to these people, Scott and Jason are the last great Survivor villains because they lend emotional stakes to the season. And to a certain point, I can get where they're coming from. For me personally, I just think they're annoying and awful, and I just don't like seeing them on my TV. Throughout the pre-merge, they routinely verbally abuse one of their fellow tribe mates, even though she's done nothing bad at all, and...
I really hope you watch this over and over, and understand that we really were trying to help you.
Oh, just fuck off. Then at the tribe swap, they get split up, and they don't seem so bad apart, but then... Aubrey fucks up, which we'll get to later, and then Scott becomes a jerk about it, and he and Jason meet up at the merge, and together with the new coalition of beauties and bronze, they come up with a new alliance. So yeah, they're annoying and obnoxious, which makes the whole Nick blindside all the more satisfying and cathartic because he was their ally and it dashed all their plans. And of course, like reasonable, mature adults, they do not respond to this by sabotaging the tribe. Well, anyways, combined with their alliance with Ty, they have two idols between them, which is especially a problem this season because of the super idol that occurs when two regular idols are paired together. Unbeknownst to the Axes of Evil, Aubrey uses her social skills to bring Ty over from the dark side, and they vote out Scott. However, the boys still don't believe they're going anywhere as they think they still have Ty. Which leads to Scott once more again having his survivor dream crushed right in front of him, except this time, it's really over. This tribal council is amazing. The juxtaposition of him being overbearingly smugly confident that he's never going anywhere to all of a sudden going somewhere because Aubrey just became the only person to successfully play around a god idol while it's still in play. Here's where I have to give credit to the argument that Scott and Jason's presence are a positive for the season at large, because few things are as satisfying as watching the downfall of these unpleasant fucks after weeks and weeks of acting like man children. In many ways, the prolonged delay of their eventual vote-offs is what makes it so satisfying. By the time the episode comes, we're dying to watch them finally get their torch snuffed, and it's so deeply cathartic when it happens because they have no idea what's going on. They think Aubrey is going because she's such a huge threat that is just playing such a phenomenally great game. Isn't that right, guys? Anyways, the fact that A, easily the best character, not only survives the vote, but does it because of her brilliant gameplay, and B, in doing so, votes off one of the biggest jerks the show has ever seen. I mean, that is like one of the most, if not the most, deeply satisfying tribal councils in recent memory. Only the Dan vote off in David vs. Goliath can even come close to matching it. Even then, almost nothing matches to the excitement that comes from knowing that this man will no longer be on our TV. However, that doesn't make the overall story of the season satisfying because of that ending. See, told you everything came back to that. You see, as I've made abundantly clear, Aubrey was the person that no matter where we were in the season, the Axes of Evil were against. Even ignoring the fact that her story is far and away the best, the biggest reason why she was the most rootable person to win is because she was always the person the villains were trying to take out. At the risk of very shallow story analysis, She's the Batman to their Joker. If Kaoh Rong really is this classic story of good versus evil, then Aubrey is undoubtedly the hero. Okay, let's expand the definition of adversary. No reason to limit it to someone who was just always against the villains. That example is just so disgustingly perfect. While we're here, let's look at other worthy candidates of winner if we're basing it on the quality of the story. Like, say, someone who had to briefly side with them because you're on their original tribe of six people and they've already shown a less than stellar opinion of women for doing nothing, and this season has already continued the unfortunate trend of people of color going home, and you're not about to upend your own game by going against the tribe leaders, so you vote with them as long as you need to, until the first vote after the merge, where you sneakily upend the alliance you had with them, and becoming their enemy because of that, but it doesn't matter, because you're no longer stuck in a corner. I mean, hypothetically, if someone like that existed in this season, and won, not only would they make a completely satisfying winner in this season in isolation, but also would make for a wonderfully worthy second inclusion into a circle that has been long underrepresented when it comes to winners of this show. I mean, yeah, that would be great. Similarly, if, say, you had a story of being the villain's lackeys because you're slightly uncomfortable with the game's premise and you think this is what you need to do to succeed, only for you to realize that it's not and there's another path available to you, and you go through an amazing redemption arc because after working with them, you're then imperative in their downfall, again, as an adversary and the reason they didn't succeed, you would also make a satisfying winner. I want to make it abundantly clear. Aubrey winning is not the only satisfying outcome from a story perspective. For a myriad of reasons, Aubrey would be the most satisfying, but her losing does not have to be the death knell in this season getting to be in most people's top 10 lists that it is. In fact, if you haven't noticed, the two others, who would not only have been good, but among some of the most satisfying winners of the show's storytelling, they all made it to the final four. The final four is comprised of three people who would have been viscerally satisfying to see win. Three people for whom would have put the perfect wrap on what now would easily be a top 10 season. Three people in that final four. There's only one problem. Three people, final four. There's a fourth person in that final four. Someone who not only had the least to do with that villain's downfall, but also is just the last obstacle standing in one of these three iconic heroes claiming the crown. And that fourth person is the one who goes on to win. Specifically because it is that jury of villains that decide the winner. Because as you know, in any classic story, the villains will not let the hero get the last laugh. If given the choice, they'll give it to someone who is best described as a background character. Not the villain, but not necessarily the hero either. And that's why, when put through the lens of classic good versus evil storytelling, Survivor is uniquely susceptible to failing at that. Unless it's like a situation like South Pacific, where it's a jury full of villains who are forced to pick between someone they hate, so of course it's going to be satisfying, because someone they hate is going to win anyway. But if it's a case like Kaoh Rong, where it's a jury of villains and a floater at the end, well, in a fucking course it's going to be unsatisfying. The villains, as the jury, get to decide who the winner is. That's how Survivor works. This is something I thought of bringing up during the Gabon review a bit, because it's sort of the same thing. For the most part, Survivor villains are, like, harmless fun. They're like, they thrive on that you love to hate them. You know, your Boston Robs, your Tysons, and the like. When you have people that seem in play, and most of them are on the jury, then the person responsible for them losing probably won't win because villains aren't exactly known for their maturity. Bob, like Michelle, had nothing to do with these people's lovely downfall, and while they're not themselves villains, they're still well-liked enough by the villains. So why should I be happy with an ending where people like Corinne, Scott, and Jason get what they want? And I didn't mention it during the Gabon review because it felt like a flimsy criticism. Like, yeah, no shit, Soul, and this reality show starring real people doesn't have a feel-good Disney ending. What did you expect? But with a common praise of both of these seasons being that they have such good storytelling, and they're such good classic tales of good versus evil, when you're an idiot and your only measure of what makes a good season is whether or not it follows the prerequisite rules of storytelling that this is a reality show doesn't need to follow, and you praise seasons for adhering to those rules, it then becomes imperative for us to point out that the seasons you're praising aren't actually good by your own merit, because it doesn't have the classic ending of a good versus evil story. And ultimately, that's okay. Despite all my complaining, the season is still actually good, even without conforming to traditional storytelling roles. But I am saying that Scott and Jason are these great villains that have such a satisfactory and cathartic downfall is sort of intellectually dishonest. I mean, they have a satisfying vote out in the moment, but as villains, they do kind of have the last laugh. And that's not very satisfying. That's why I always say the season is good in spite of Scott and Jason, not because of it. And calling them the last real villains because you have a stunted view of what makes emotional stakes, well, you do you. But because this isn't a story of heroes versus villains, none of that stuff is really compelling, it's just blah. Because instead what we get is Scott and Jason being mean to people, sabotaging the camp, throwing the water on the fire, and yay, they get voted out, it's all satisfying, but then they still get the ending that they preferred, so what was the point of all this? It's not because it's a satisfying defeat the villain story. All it is, in the case of Scott and Jason, is annoying. So after all that, surely we're almost done with the video, right? It's not like there's a whole other section to go, right? I've spent over 3,000 words talking about Kaoh Rong while only occasionally touching up to the actual debate of Michelle versus Aubrey from a game perspective. I feel like I should get some sort of medal for that. But it's time to actually get into the nitty-gritty of that debate. A debate that existed even before the season's end results. Remember the edgikers? I think most people thought Aubrey was going to win. Hell, I thought Aubrey was going to win. And I think the reason people thought that is because she kind of had the real winner's edit. By which I mean, hers was an actual story, and not just a random collection of forced confessionals awkwardly shoved in that people ran with. Hers was a winner's edit if you were watching the season as a meaningful story, and not as a math chart that you can then shout, equating to my calculations during. Because my god, Aubrey's story is so moving. Like I said, she transformed from a person who was breaking down on day two to someone who's controlling the entire boot order by the mid-merge. The whole Aubrey versus Michelle debate has been argued to death at this point for time and memorial. And in the words of Aubrey, if her and Michelle had a nickel for every time their names were brought up in conjunction with each other, they'd have enough money to be on a yacht with Oprah, not worrying about Survivor ever again. It's tired, y'all. The mere fact that we're arguing over whether or not the winner deserved to win 5 years later feels like a pretty big signifier in and of itself, but if you want to say that Winners at War showed those Aubrey was robbed truthers what's what, then hey, you do you, boo. I myself wouldn't even be talking about this debate if it weren't for the fact that I'm doing a review of Kaoh Rong, and not doing so would be a massive oversight. Because despite being pretty well decided in my stance on the argument, or hell, maybe even because of that, I think we can put the argument to rest. It's over. It's worn out. If you think Michelle played the better game, more power to you. If you think Aubrey played the better game, more power to you. But I think enough is enough. It's funny, Michelle herself said that both of them got what the other one wanted. Aubrey wanted the crown and the victory that Michelle got, and Michelle wanted the respect and the enthusiasm that Aubrey got. And that right there encapsulates the entire argument better than I ever could. A lot of the fan base thinks that Aubrey played the better game, but at the end of the day, she's not the one in the winner's circle. Michelle is. Can't we just leave it like that? The horse is beyond dead. Beating it won't do anyone any good. However, since we're here, I guess this is as good an opportunity as any to take a better look at Aubrey's game and discuss the strengths and weaknesses of it. Because I think in the effort of trying to combat all the needless hate that Michelle got for winning, a lot of fans pendulum swung to the opposite direction and started calling Aubrey's game trash, which I don't think is fair. Were there mistakes in her game? Absolutely, definitely, yes. Egregious mistakes. But I think her good gameplay outweighed those bad mistakes. And today, we're going to look at her entire game, the good and the bad. At the tribal right before the merge, Aubrey is faced with a choice. vote out smarmy previous fellow Brain Tribe member Peter, whom you don't really know where he stands due to you previously voting out his ally. You're pretty sure that come the merge, he will defect and not work with the Brains. On the other hand, he is still a Brain, and Julia is someone who is almost completely unknown. She's not sure where Julia stands either, and doesn't know if she'll work with the Beauties. Aubrey gets very wishy-washy right before and during the vote, and she eventually does decide to vote out Peter, but, Aubrey, what the fuck is this shit? Why would you do that? Did you not see the other pieces of parchment? What in the world could have possibly compelled you to not just throw away that parchment and use another piece of parchment? Why did you write Julia's name and then just cross it out? What are you thinking? This was a horrible move, and one that probably would have gotten her voted out at the merge if it weren't for the medical evacuation of an ally she had that ended up saving her. Huh. Okay, so for the sake of argument, let's say that Julia and Scott do work with Aubrey and Joe. Even in a timeline where Aubrey just votes Peter out, no crossed out Julia vote at all, and even though the numbers of Beauties, Bronze, and Brains are exactly the same as they are in our current timeline, who's to say that the Bronze don't just join the Beauties anyway? Which brings us to our most likely conclusion that the biggest mistake she did was just not really choosing, ultimately getting the worst of both worlds, with Julia not trusting you and also giving the Beauties and Bronze the numbers they need to come together and vote you out. It is important to mention that at the merge, she isn't the immediate next target. It's Neil, but Neil has an idol, so she's the next best thing. Anyway, Neil gets evacuated, and despite the show's best efforts to do so, this actually probably helped Aubrey, as like we said, she probably would have been the merge boot had this not happened. And of course, this is the thing that gets thrown in Aubrey Stan's faces when we point out how much of a hindrance it was when Joe got taken out at Final Five. People always turn around and say, well, Neil's evac helped her. She was destined to be the merge boot. As if every medevac in any point in the game is created equal. And also, as if saying that because this one thing helped her, that means that other thing didn't hurt her. Because here's the thing. If Neil's medevac really was as vital for Aubrey's game as they like to say it was, she would have been voted out at the next tribal council. I don't know how to tell you this, but a medevac at Final 11 is very different than a medevac at Final 5. Because when there's 10 people left, unless it's like a Redemption Island level boring season, things aren't set in stone. There's still a whole lot of game left, and things can change on a dime. It's a lot easier to play around an evacuation messing up your plans at 11 than it is at 5. Aubrey's game is mostly poisoned by a lot of really rotten luck, and I'm not going to count it against her when one incredibly lucky thing goes her way. Especially because this is what the Alliance really wanted anyway. Aubrey was just the backup plan. There was no reason the Alliance had to implode the way it did. Hey, wait a minute. I'm just realizing this right now, but this should have helped them. Because Neil being eliminated is what they wanted. And the idol was the only reason they couldn't do it. Aubrey's position wasn't bad. She was just the next best thing. They wanted Neil out, that they got what they wanted, they were able to work around the idol, and they still imploded! This alliance is terrible! Aubrey was in a really shitty position that was only partially her fault. So when one good thing finally went her way, she capitalized on it and made really important, vital relationships that helped her throughout the rest of the game. Aligning with Sydney and Ty, who are really great players in their own right. After Sydney and Aubrey solidify their alliance and vote out Nick, Aubrey starts playing phenomenally. Her reads throughout the post-merge are incredibly impeccable, and not only that, she capitalizes on those reads really, really well. She thinks that Julia is playing both sides, and she is. She's terrified of the super idol, which she should be. Meanwhile, Debbie here is leaking all kind of information to the other side because she's somehow incapable of realizing when people are double agents. Knowing that if they go through with this plan, that Scott and Jason would know exactly where to vote and play the super idol for maximum efficiency. So realizing that Debbie, as an alliance mate, has become a liability, she votes her out, actually utilizing Julia to do so. Which, if she was as good player as people think, she would have taken this opportunity to vote Sydney out, which is what the Axis people wanted, but whatever. And of course, she famously flips Ty over her side, and then gets him to betray the Axes of Evil. And in doing so, she flexes on every future cast member of 888 and Edge of Extinction by doing something they could never dream of. In fact, she does something that no other player had done before, no since. She effectively plays around a super idol and actually eliminates it from the game while it was still eligible to use. I mean, shit. People nowadays are too chicken shit to play around regular idols, and here this woman is just casually doing it around god idols. I mean, god. We really have no choice but to stand. She plays this round amazingly, which is what makes her next awful move all the more glaring. At Final Six, Ty is itching to get rid of Michelle, because he rightfully believes her to be the biggest jury threat, as she hasn't really done anything to piss people off. However, the rest of the Alliance wants to just finish the job and vote out the last remaining member of the Axis of Evil, since they're kind of on a roll. Sydney especially doesn't like this idea, since she's closely aligned with her. However, Ty is an extra vote, so all he has to do is get a couple of other people on his side to get the numbers. And this is where Aubrey slips up, because she, like Ty, also recognizes the threat that is eventual Winchell, and agrees that it is the best move. And as Scott himself once said, Joe is basically Aubrey's own extra vote, so that's the majority right there. You don't even need Sydney. This is a great move, and then she just doesn't do it. What? I know it's not fair to play the hindsight game, but this is really Aubrey's losing move. Should it matter because she already has her winnable final three with Ty and Joe? I mean, no, but she herself already sees this as the correct move that it is, and she just doesn't take the opportunity to do so. This after the impeccable reads that she had during the post-merge, and it all goes to shit because of this one terrible move at Final Six. And even though Jason's torch got snuffed, she really lost the game here. Except, it really shouldn't have. Because even though these blunders are terrible, and I do not want to understate them, they are terrible moves, she still has her set Final Three, right? Like, in Redemption Island, it's better for Rob's game to take out Ashley before Grant, but it doesn't matter because he already knows who he's going to the end with, Philip and Natalie. So as long as he can prevent both Grant and Ashley from going to the end, it doesn't really matter what order they go out. Same thing here with Michelle and Jason. She knows she has a winnable Final Three, she takes the boys to the end, the bitter jury forces a tie 4 seasons early, 4 votes for Joe, 4 votes for Aubrey, Ty comes in and breaks the tie, voila, Aubrey is the Survivor winner. Clean, right? That's a perfect game plan. I mean, the only things that could potentially mess that up are, one, an immunity threat winning their way to the end, which, because Survivor is sexist, Jason better fits the definition of that than Michelle, and two, if, like, say, someone was randomly medically evacuated right near the end of the game. But that's certainly not going to happen. Right? Right? So, yeah, that's exactly what happens. Michelle is a 2-time finalist because Joe ate too much beef. And this is where I have to reinforce that Joe's and Nick's evacs weren't created equal when it comes to Aubrey's game. It's wildly understated how badly Joe's elimination fucked up everything Aubrey was working toward. The real reason she lost the game was because of something that was completely outside of her control. While it would have behooved her to take another goat with her for insurance, there was no reason that she absolutely had to. Still a bad move, but it shouldn't have been damning. And even with those 2 very awful moves, the rest of the stuff she did amazingly should have been enough to outweigh those 2 strategic blunders. Besides the final 6 vote, Aubrey plays this post-merge spectacularly well, and if the jury weren't ridiculously bitter, they would have seen that. She even continues playing fabulously. After bad luck continues to go her way and Michelle wins the final immunity challenge, Aubrey, as the biggest threat, does not get voted out unanimously, but instead, like Natalie before her, she throws Jeff's philosophy right back in his face, this time by getting it to go to fire. The relationship she cultivated with Ty was strong enough to get him to force a Final 4 fire making between her and Sydney at the vote right before the final tribal council. And it may seem weird that I'm being so unapologetic in my stance here when I previously denounced other controversial results like Guatemala and All-Stars and Samoa. During my Guatemala and Samoa reviews, I made a big point that since Russell and Stephanie had winnable final tribals, and even more damning, they were in complete control of the game, so they could have taken those to the end, then them losing was completely on them. In a regular, normal version of these reviews, I would condemn Aubrey's decision to vote Jason out and say that's the end of it, bing bang boom, harsh, quick, and merciless condemnations of her game. But I don't think it's that easy, because as I keep pointing out, the reason of her lack of a winnable Final Three has nothing to do with her, unless she has some sort of power over Joe's digestive system that I don't know about. The other side of the argument is that I think by merely even comparing the two, I feel like we're being intellectually dishonest. Because Aubrey's jury management is nowhere near the level of abysmal that it is with Russell or Stephanie. If anything, the mere fact we're talking about winnable Final Threes as if they're in short supply is part of the problem. because it shouldn't be. She has not done, at least from what we've seen, anything to the jury that would warrant that level of disdain. And that's not even talking about the good players who don't even have any chance of winning. Like, Sydney wins no endgame combinations, which is just so depressing to me. Because, like I said, Vesipia and Sydney, even though it's, again, it's still short supply, would still at least be better than just Vesipia in that circle. And even ignoring that, Sydney's a good player. She shouldn't have to go to the end with goats because she's already a good player. Do you realize that if Sydney and Aubrey go to the end with Joe, then Joe Del Campo is eligible for Winners at War? Does that not make anyone rethink this idea that the jury is always right? Let's face it, Aubrey getting second place has nothing to do with anything she did in the game, and everything to do with this jury being unusually bitter. Bitter juries are another contentious point in the Survivor fandom, with some saying that there's no such thing as bitter juries, with others saying that there are such thing, but it's the player's responsibility to make them not feel that way, to others saying that because a jury is a part of the game, then the jury is able to decide who played the best game based on whatever criteria they want, and that's valid. Like, they can decide you like, they can decide that they want you to win because you have blue eyes or something. Let's ignore the awful implications that that has, why don't we? And at the end of the day, they are right. I mean, the jury does decide who they think played the best game. Regardless of what our opinions on the matter is, the fact is the winner because the juries decide. That's who wins the game. That's what makes Survivor Survivor. And as I may have mentioned, the unpredictable human nature of it is what makes it as a game way more interesting to me than something like The Amazing Race. However, one element of this equation I vehemently disagree with is the idea of calling the runner-ups that lose in seasons with juries like these as flops. I don't think that's fair at all, because they weren't able to live up to the random, often contradictory criteria that the jury just made up because they were really just mad that you outplayed them. As we've seen, Survivor is very susceptible to luck, be it bad or good, and if we're judging who a good player is based on how much they expend their win equity, then Aubrey is obviously a better player than Michelle or Ty in, like, every discussion. Aubrey did everything she could to save herself from a near-damning situation at the merge, and eventually became the one in the driver's seat. She excellently managed to get herself into a winning position, despite the lack of respect that the jury had for her because she voted out the jerks. And the only reason it didn't pan out was because Joe ate too much beef. And FYI, the jurors actually agree with me about Aubrey's gameplay. Scott may have given half-assed contradictory reasons as to why Aubrey lost his vote, ranging from everything to she got weaker as the game went on, or she had an extra advantage with Joe as her extra vote. But when they thought she was on her way out, the boys commended her for being the strong competitor that she is, even using it as a reason they needed to vote her out. Despite their efforts to describe her game as being fear-based and paranoid when they were bitter that she voted them out, by their own admission, they know that's a crock. She didn't play a bad game, she played a great game. They were just too bitter to acknowledge it. This isn't a Samoa situation. These people were just acting like bitter babies because they lost a game. You can see it in the Ponderosa videos. They actively, completely shut Sydney out and didn't even acknowledge her as a person because she beat them in a game. Here's something. When asked who he was basing his game off of, Jason answered with Russell Hance. I mean, if there's anyone that should be able to appreciate and respect aggressive gameplay, maybe, I don't know, just maybe the fucking Russell stan should. There's a whole slew of additional stuff to talk about regarding this topic, like from the fact that some of the criteria the jurors used was just factually incorrect at times, to the idea that Aubrey getting criticized for playing a paranoid and fear-based game, even though when Tony was doing that in the first Brains Bronze Beauty, he was being praised for that. That sounds like an example of a very real gender bias, but this video is already getting way too long as it is, so instead I will direct you to an amazing post written by user BlueCJJ on how the results-oriented, jury-always-gets-it-right mentality is an incomplete and heavily flawed way of analyzing the game and the merits of the actual players. That amazingly detailed post really defined a lot about this section, and it's just excellently well-written. You should definitely check it out. Another really excellent Reddit post that's more specifically about Kaoh Rong is this one from you/notkillingitpodcast. I've just dedicated an entire overly long video section explaining why Aubrey winning was more satisfying on a gameplay level, but he specifically talks about why her winning was more satisfying on a storytelling level, something that I touched on. In fact, I touched on because of that post. It was just really excellently well done. He brilliantly explains all the reasons the fans were voting for Aubrey, explaining that had she won, this season would become like one of the show's most celebrated seasons of all time. Aubrey had won, Kaoh Rong would have become one of the most celebrated seasons in the history of the show. Aubrey would have become one of the most celebrated winners. Kaoh Rong would have become the season people held up all the way until season 37 for new viewers. In a way that has since been cerebrally reasoned away in the years since, people viscerally understood at the time how close we were to having such a unique, triumphant, completely satisfying trio of season, winner, and story. It happens so rarely in Survivor, so people felt it when Aubrey lost because essentially the cool kids didn't want to reward her game. He discusses the complex attributes of Aubrey's story, how she was a fantastic narrator, how she overcame numerous obstacles, how she was the pinnacle hero who triumphed against some very gross villains, made it to the end by swaying the other lovable hero to her side against said evil villains. I mentioned earlier that while yes, Sydney and Ty would have been very good winners, Aubrey was the main character of the season. She was the one whose story was told and the one from whom we were being told the story from. It's actually astounding how satisfying Aubrey's win would have been from both a gameplay and storytelling perspective. Usually it's one or the other. It's no secret that I think Parvati played the best game on Heroes vs. Villains, but even I can't deny how fucking perfect it is for the story of that season that Russell's biggest adversary was the one that ended up winning. Like, that's just pitch-perfect storytelling right there. Or take Edge of Extinction. On a gameplay level, I can't actually defend Gavin or Julie beating Chris in any meaningful way, but on a storytelling level, it's just so weird to have the third boot win. Here, though, it's disappointing no matter what way you look at it. Honestly, I think Kaoh Rong should have been a final two. I think that's what most people thought it should have been, especially if you looked at the math. I think that would have been better, because the main character of the season, the one that went through the most growth and is the one who would definitely win, if not for them getting voted out on the final day, I mean, shit, that's like perfect classic Survivor right there. Someone on that comment section of that post said it best. I remember watching at the time, and most people felt like it was going to be a final two. All the speculation and Edgic either had Aubrey as third place or the winner. That's just how it felt, because it seemed if Aubrey made it to the end, she won. So the suspense was whether or not she'd make it. Even the castaways themselves, while filming, thought it would be a final two, because the final four tribal council happened on day 37. A lot of people hated the Kaoh Rong ending because it felt out of place. I can't remember who wrote it, but someone wrote that a season that could have no wrong ending came up with one. It was ingrained in people's minds that Aubrey was either third or first, and that a second place just felt wrong. That honestly sums it up better than I ever could. The story that we were being told and the results that we got were incongruent. Or maybe not, with almost half the jury being comprised of people like Scott, Jason, and Debbie, it makes sense that the person who played the best game wouldn't win. Like I said, Survivor offers that unique circumstance where the more epic the downfall the villain has, the less likely it is for the person responsible for that downfall to win. I've long thought that the fact that both Aubrey's gameplay and personality wasn't well respected by that particular group of people to in fact be the biggest testament of both of those things she could have ever received. I've heard some people say that Aubrey played a horrible game and was just really lucky, and I just could not disagree with that more. I think it's completely the opposite. When you look at what she actually did and how she accomplished it, I think it's clear that she is the best player of the season. She's just not the winner. People talk about social game as if it's some get-out-of-jail-free card that you can just throw around to defend your favorite boring player. Michelle had a great social game. That's how she survived the four tribal councils. She was vulnerable. Not because she wasn't really a threat. But here's the thing. Social and strategy are not diametrically opposed aspects of the game. Aubrey cultivating a good enough relationship with Ty to get him to flip on his alliance is an example of good social game. Ew, but she was so cool to people outside of her alliance. Oh wow, she wasn't chummy with the Axes of Evil? Clearly she has no social skills. People were praising Tommy for winning the game with a great social game, and praising him for being the first person to win the game since Samoa with no idols, advantages, or immunity wins. What people don't seem to realize is that had Aubrey taken the crown, she would have been all those things as well, except that she would have actually been fun to watch and been entertaining television, and, well, we can't have that. Which brings us to the other half of the discussion. As I said, I want to be fair and look at the finalist games objectively, so I'm going to try to say something nice about Michelle's game. Here we go. She...
Of course I do. Your hair is, very... hat. You're a... hat owner. You're also hat...
She wants some crucial immunities? I guess that's something, like, what do you want from me? Like, I know you guys don't like to hear this, but she really wasn't that involved with the storyline at all. Like, she didn't go to Tribal Council until day 24, and even then she only went to, like, 4 Tribal Councils. From not going to Tribal Council the first 24 days of the game, to then being a non-threat, to then being a threat, but she just wins immunities. I mean, she's really just the female version of Fabio. She's a non-entity on the season that she won. The real reason I didn't talk about Michelle that much in the Michelle versus Aubrey debate is because it was never really about Michelle. Michelle may have been the punching bag for obnoxious Aubrey stands to beat at, but it wasn't really about her. She never deserved that level of hate that she got. I mean, even if she was a bad player, she didn't deserve the hate she got. Almost no one deserves that, make that clear. But, like, people weren't mad at her. They were mad at the person who beat Aubrey. It would have been the same thing had it been Joe. After the finale, the war between Aubrey and Michelle stands became incredibly heated, and because Nuance on the Internet is dead, it became very easy for someone to interpret Yay Aubrey as Boo Michelle, and vice versa. And frankly, that sentiment needs to die. It is not Michelle's fault that the jury was comprised of crybabies. She was in the right place at the right time. Nothing more to it. Once upon a time, the woman who was painted by a story as the ultimate hero that we were all supposed to be rooting for became the villain just like that, all of a sudden, and was ultimately put down or lost the game. And the winner ended up being someone who seemed largely irrelevant to the season. This parallel not only is another way for me to shamelessly stand for Aubrey and also talk about how horrible the ending of Game of Thrones was, but also brings the strengths of the season and the failures of Game of Thrones to light. Because even with all that, like Aubrey's other two seasons we've talked about, despite the horrible ending, I had a lot of fun rewatching this season. I had an absolute blast talking about the season. I feel like this is going to be one of my best reviews yet. Game of Thrones ending retroactively makes the entire thing unfun to watch. Meanwhile, this season is still a blast. It's just not ever going to find itself in my top 10 by the end of this whole project. But if during voting at Final Tribal Council, 4 bitter children had become adults at the end and written an A at the voting booth, it would have.